accepted it, it almost didn't surprise them at that point. When I called them and told them I was going to go in the circus, they were surprised. But then I've kept wandering around doing various things, and now they just say, "Where are you?" And they don't seem to be surprised with what am I doing there.
And for anybody on the blue team, but especially the two rookies, launch day is going to be the most exciting day of your life, I assume. And then a couple of hours later, while the rest of the crew gets space hab going and everything else, you guys get to go to sleep. How difficult is it going to be trying to get the adrenaline down and going to sleep that first time in space?
I'll take that one. I think it's going to be very difficult. That's why we're focusing now in advance on being sure that we can get things done very quickly, efficiently, on time, we hope, and do whatever measures are necessary to get ourselves in bed. We don't have a long first sleep period. It's only 6 hours, so we recognize then the importance of getting to bed on time, and we have a long day for flight day two ahead of us, so all the more reason to do whatever it takes to get to sleep.
Jerry Hannifin, Time Magazine. I guess this is one for Mike Anderson. I'd like to know something more about fire on board. How do you control these little balls of fire? And what is the objective of all this? What is the meaning of this? Are you looking for a fuel that'll burn with no oxides or whatever it is?
Well, that's a great question, but I think I'd like to turn that question over to KC, since she's actually going to be the primary person working that experiment. So, KC, if you want to talk a little bit about that.
Sure. Within the combustion module, we are going to be doing three different experiments. The first one studies soot formation, and the reason we are doing it in space is, first of all, soot is a bad thing. It means bad for the environment, bad for human health, bad for fuel efficiency. So the combustion chemists want to figure out how to reduce the amount of soot by modeling. And one way to model soot is to study the turbulent diffusion flames, because these diffusion flames produce soot. However, in combustion chemistry, when you have turbulence and soot, these are two very hard problems. These are the hardest problems. So the chemists have figured out, the combustion chemists and the modelers, that if we can make this problem simpler, that is, take the turbulence part out and just study soot, then perhaps we can extend whatever we learn to the turbulent soot-forming flames that we have on Earth. So we go to space because the laminar diffusion flames behave just like the turbulent diffusion flames, and only place where we can have these laminar diffusion flames is space or microgravity. The part that you talked about, how we burn these things and the safety aspect of it, basically the flames are burnt in an enclosed module, what we call the experiment chamber. And it's the amount of fuel we are putting in there is really very, very small. And after the fuel is used up, it's the combustion products, which are basically benign, we vent them to space. And even then, we do analysis to find out what's left out there. Besides this one experiment, since Mike alluded to a number of experiments in flames, we have two more, which we do within the combustion module. The second one studies what's called flame balls. This one is actually, for people who are intrigued by basic science, a very interesting experiment, because long time ago, a Russian scientist, just while solving mathematical equations, figured that for a certain set of equations, you have a solution in just spherical geometry, that you would get flame balls. Now, in 1G, the gravity that we live in, it's really not possible to see an evidence of that. So the equations were solved, the solution was shown, but nobody really thought anything of it till this professor, Mr. Dr. Ronnie from University of California. He was doing drop tower tests and found in this very small video that he had captured, lo and behold, there are flame balls. And he remembered this particular equation from his college days and correlated the two and then carried on a few more experiments. And his interest perked to put this particular experiment in space because, one, you are doing these flame balls at the leanest possible mixture settings. So it's a good thing in fuel combustion efficiency if you can do something at the leanest possible fuel mixture ratio, because it obviously saves you a lot of fuel. The second thing is, if we can model this aspect, then we have done part of the combustion chemistry problem and rest of the equation set becomes simpler. So in order to see this and correlate with the equations, he actually flew this particular experiment on STS-93. And then they learned a lot of lessons while doing the parametric studies, and on our flight is being done in a lot more detail. And the third experiment is MIST, where again, within the experiment module, we have a tube where fuel and air are premixed, and we burn the flame essentially to figure out or come up with a method for better fire suppression. Now, why do we want to do that? Because most of the conventional methods use toxic materials, which are becoming outdated, and there's constant pressure to come up with better, more user-friendly materials for fire suppression efficacy. In this particular experiment called MIST, basically a flame would move in this chamber and MIST is imparted on it, and we study different parameters like the speed and the size of these particles which interact with the flame to see what size is the best size, etc. So those are the three big experiments where we make flames or play with fire, as Mike said.
I'm Sue Butler, and I have a question for Colonel Ramon. Would you tell us a little bit about the multispectral camera for recording desert aerosols? What exactly are desert aerosols?
Desert aerosols are small, tiny little particles of dust that are coming out of, if we're talking about the Mediterranean area, they are coming out of the Saharan desert. And after they're going up there, they're moving by the weather phenomena over the Mediterranean from one side and the Middle East, and from the other side, they transverse over the Atlantic Ocean and arrive until Mexico and Florida sometimes. These little particles of dust have an impact on weather and precipitation, and that's the research that two of the University of Israel professors are going to conduct. The camera itself is a multi-spectral camera. It has six wavelengths, and we are going to take photos from space of the dust storms while taking them simultaneously in those six wavelengths. In the same time, we plan to have an airplane, instrumented airplane, flying within these dust storms in the atmosphere, taking some samples and more data. And in the same time, we have some ground stations that will collect also data. And this infusion of data will enable us to better understand the impact of these tiny little dust particles.
Hi, this is Chris Kreidler from Florida Today. Since you're divided into teams, I assume a lot of your training has been as teams separately. So I wondered what you've done to make yourself feel like a whole crew together, and if there are any good-natured rivalries going on between the two teams.
Go ahead, Laurel.
Well, actually, much of our training has been together, not separate, or at least not separated by the blue team and the red team. Some of us are training for flight deck activities, and there's an ascent team. As we mentioned, Dave and I switch, so Dave's doing some of the training for ascent, and I'm doing training with the flight deck crew for entry. And then there are several of us who train together on payloads that are on different shifts. So there's actually very little until just recently, in the last month or month and a half, when we started doing our joint integrated sims with Mission Control, where we're actually split into our two shifts. And it's a little hard sometimes because I miss the folks on the other shift and we don't get much time to see them. Of course, there's all kinds of little rivalries. They're harmless. I mean, you know, who's done the best job keeping things stay neat, and who's been the best job keeping track of what's gone on to pass on to the next crew and that sort of thing.
This is Phil Chen again for Alon. A lot of astronauts tell me that when you're in space, with very rare exceptions, you can't see any borders. Any thoughts about that? And especially since you're involved with the education experiments, what that would mean to all of the children of the world who might be following your flight, even the ones in countries which are normally adversaries to Israel?
Yes, and you know, when I first came to NASA about 4 years ago, I was amazed to walk in the corridors and see all these international guys, and I was sure I'm not in the U.S. I even was amazed more to hear American astronauts speaking Russian and French and Japanese. So there are no borders from you can't recognize border from space, and I think you can't also recognize borders here in NASA. And this is one of the greatest things about NASA. And I am an Israeli, and I feel like I'm at home. I'm sure that all the other international astronauts feel the same. And I think we serve science for humankind, and this doesn't have any borders as well.
With, the former NASA Administrator Dan Golden, after he came back from one of his Israel trips, he emphasized to me that the MEDEX experiment is pure science. It's got no strategic or military value. And I asked him about how he would feel about NASA sharing the data with the other countries in the area who are also affected by these aerosols and dusts, including the ones which have been Israel's adversaries either in the past or the present. And his comment back to me was, why not? It's science, and everybody in the world should benefit from science. And I'm just wondering, how do you feel about that?
Of course, science, again, science is done for the human kind, wherever they are. And it's one of every scientist's obligation to share his findings. And this goes for every experiment that we are going to do on board of STS-107 or on every experiment that NASA does, including MEDEX. Of course, we will share all the information, all the data, and as you know, the Israeli scientists are working in collaboration with the NASA scientists, and everything is going to be shared.
And for Rick, you've been keeping much too quiet for your first command, so let me give you a question. Big picture, if you were writing the history books 5, 10, 20 years from now, how would you want this picture, this mission to be thought of as? What do you want the world to take from this mission?
Well, I would say that from the standpoint of the way that we as a crew would like to see this mission go, is that we want to do the absolute best job that we possibly can on every facet of the mission. We have worked very hard on our training, not only to fly the orbiter, but also to conduct the experiments on orbit. And we want to ensure that the experiments that we fly